So can everybody else. Okay, so then we will continue with the second part of this presentation, and I'm now trying to move to the next slide. Yes, indeed. So we will move on to the second part of this presentation, and because yeah, we have not finished to define yet how Plexus input exactly works. As was said in the beginning, we have five modes. Now, Stefan has just touched the first three modes of input. And now I will discuss the other two modes of Plexus input, and I will also talk a little bit on the output program. So, so this is the program structure again. We have Plexus input, we have Plexus output. Now the gray part, the first line definition of the problem, is the part that Stefanos just did. Now it looks like he only did very little, but that is of course not true. I mean, he discussed the main part of Plexus input, and I will just do the remaining part. So again, we have the overview of the modes here. So the soil and structures mode and the mesh mode were just discussed, and we will now talk about the flow conditions mode and the stage construction mode. So let's start with the flow conditions mode. In the flow conditions mode, we can specify all the things that are related to, as the name already says, flow. This can be water flow. This can also be thermal flow. Now, the thermal flow part, we will completely leave out of this these four sessions. Maybe at some point we're going to do some additional online training on that, but we just focus on water since the vast majority of Plexus users regularly needs to define water flow in their soil, but not so many actually need to define the thermal flow. So we just focus here on the water part of the flow conditions mode. Now, what kind of water levels do we have? Well, we first have to distinguish, and that is purely a naming thing, in borehole water levels as well as user water levels. What is the difference between the two? Well, when we define the borehole, we could already specify a head value. We could per layer actually specify whether in that layer we want to have a different piezometric level. For instance, because we have a sand layer that is caught in between two clay layers, and the sand layer is connected to a lake somewhere in the mountains, and therefore the sand layer is an aquifer. It has a different water level. We can specify that in the borehole. Now, as soon as we move to the flow conditions mode, then Plexus actually interprets that data from the different layers in the borehole into water levels. So it will generate a water level that represents the head. It may generate water levels that represents the different piezometric levels of the different layers and assigns them. And all those levels just get the name borehole water level, so that you know that those water levels that occur in the flow conditions mode are actually generated by Plexus based on your borehole information. Now, on top of that, we can also define our own water levels. For instance, you want to make an excavation, and in the excavation, you want to lower the water level. That is something that I, as a user, have to define. So when I create in flow conditions mode, on top of the borehole water levels that I already have, additional water levels, those will automatically get the name user water level. So they're both water levels. They work the same from engineering point of view. They just have different names so that you as a user know the origin of a water level. If you have a whole list of water levels, you know that the borehole water levels are the ones that Plexus generated. The user water levels are the ones that you put in yourself. You could, by the way, always give a different name to a water level. If you want to assign a user water level the name phreatic level after excavation to -2 meters, you can do so. You can change the name and give it a name that it makes more sense to you for this specific project. Now, on top of that, and that is more based on functionality, one of those water levels has to be what we call the global water level. Why do we need a global water level? Well, as you can imagine, is we don't want to particularly assign for every little bit of soil in our model what water level is going to be used there. So what Plexus does is says, well, if you don't explicitly assign a water level to a certain soil area, then we just give it some default level, and that default is the global water level. And in principle, this global water level initially is based on the head value of your borehole. So if you fill in a head value of plus 5 meters, then Plexus will create a water level at plus 5 meters, and it will make it the global water level. And any soil that you don't explicitly say what water level is going to be applied in that soil will then become the get the global water level. You can, during the calculation, change the global water level to another level. So you can now say that another water level from this moment on has to be the global level. That can be a borehole water level, it can be a user water level. The whole idea about a global water level is to have at least a default water level in case you didn't tell Plexus what water level is going to be applied there. Now, how can we assign that? There are a couple of options. If you have in water conditions mode, in this case it's a big dam construction, you can select a certain area, it will become red. Then you can either in the selection explorer from the part that you just selected, go to the water conditions option in the selection explorer, and then click on the drop-down box, and then you have a couple of options. You can also, in the graphical representation, right-click on that red area, and then you get a list of possibilities. But then you can say whether a certain area, a certain soil area, has either the global level, which is already the default, but you could change it to another level and later decide that you want to put it back. You can give it a custom level, in which case you have to pick which other water level of the defined water levels you want to assign. You can just specify it as a head value. So you can say, well, I don't want to pick a water level. This has a head of plus 10 meters, and then you can do so. You can make a user-defined distribution, in which case you have to give at a certain reference level what is the pore pressure and then an increment per depth. You could use that if you want the increment to be more than the water weight. So instead of an increment of 10 kilopascal per meter depth, you want to have 12 or 14, or maybe even want to decrease it with depth, and sometimes in clay layers that is also possible. We have the option to interpolate. So what an interpolate option does is that it takes the water, the pore pressure, directly above the layer and directly below, and it just does a linear interpolation of pore pressures over the height of the layer where you assign the property interpolate. And for instance, you have a clay layer in between two sand layers. The two sand layers have different heads. The clay layer we set to interpolate, so the clay layer just checks in the sand layer in the limit with the sand layer above what is the pore pressure on that border. It does the same directly below. It takes those two pore pressures and just does a linear interpolation over the height of my clay layer to interpolate the pore pressures. And the last option is to set it dry. And well, as the name already says, if you set it dry, then your soil has no pore pressures, it will be perfectly dry. This can be used very fast, for instance, in an excavation to just say that a certain area should be completely dry. No soil, no water. So we said that it's dry. And as I said, you can do that from the selection explorer, or you can just right click with the mouse on the area where you want to make the change. Now, this is only part one of defining my calculation construction. Part two is the construction, the stage construction mode, where we can do basically anything else that is not related to water flow and thermal flow. So, first of all, what we have to do is that we have to... yes?
Sorry to break. We got a lot of requests from people that want to have like a 5-minute break. They're really desperate to go to the toilet. If we do a quick break here,
yeah, sure.
So we can continue. I see there was a few questions open, so maybe we can handle the questions here, and then at least some people can have a quick break.
Okay, that is so fine with me. Yes.
Yeah, so let's continue with the presentation in 5 minutes, if that's fine.
It is perfectly fine with me, so I can imagine everybody running away now. So
oh, and then we'll continue in 5 minutes.
Yeah, should I, in the meantime, answer a few questions live, or should I also wait with that?
Yeah, we can answer a few questions in the meantime for people who cannot go away from the computer.
Yeah. Well, for instance, one of the questions that we saw coming in more than one time is that people say, well, I want to enter coordinates at the command line. How do I do that? They have been playing around by separating coordinates with brackets and commas and colons and just use spaces. So if you want to enter a point, then you at a location X is 10, Y is 4, at the command line, you can just specify point space 10 space 4. So just white spaces in between. If it's a line, so you have to specify a beginning and the end point, you can just specify all the four coordinates with spaces. You are allowed to use brackets around them. So let's say your line goes from 0, 0 to 5, 5. You can say line space 0, space 0, space 5, space 5. But if you want to, you can put the 0, space 0 in between brackets and the 5, space 5 also in between brackets. That is not necessary though. It does make it easier to recognize the pairs of coordinates. So if you want to put in a polygon with a lot of points and you just keep typing the coordinates, it might get a bit confusing at some point and the brackets might help for you. It's not necessary. I hope everybody can still hear me. Another question coming in said, yeah, you explained about the head, but what is exactly the head? The head in a borehole is just, you could say, it's the physical water level in your soil. So if you specify a head in your borehole, all the layers automatically get pore pressures according to the head that you specify. However, if you want to have a layer that is something else, you can explicitly say so. So again, head is like the default pore pressure distribution for your borehole. If you don't specify anything else, all the layers will have a pore pressure distribution according to the head. If you want to have some layers to work in a different way, then you can explicitly say so. So, yeah, head is a default value, and head then translates in global water level, and then in flow conditions mode, that the global water level is then the default for all the soil again. So head and global water level are very interconnected, and then they represent the default pore water pressures that are being applied by Plexus, unless you tell Plexus to do something different. Are there any other somebody has been already browsing through material parameters, and he says, well, you have two options here in material parameters. One is called OCR and the other one is called POP. OCR is over consolidation ratio, but what does POP mean? POP is pre-overburden pressure. I won't go into too much details, but you could say over-consolidation is a factor. So you say that the maximum stress that was reached in the soil at some point is a multiplier over the current stress. So the maximum stress was 1.5 times higher than the current stress. That is OCR. Pre-overburden pressure is that the difference between the limit stress, the highest stress once reached and the current one is a fixed value in kilopascal. So if I fill in a pre-overburden pressure of 100 kilopascal in a certain layer, let's say it's a top layer that is 5 meters high, that means that my overconsolidation pressure at the ground level where my current stress is zero is then 100, the POP value. At the bottom of my layer, let's say my current stress is 70 kPa, then the overconsolidation pressure there is 170 kPa. The current stress, 70, plus the POP. So POP is a difference between pre-consolidation pressure and current pressure in kilopascals. Overconsolidation is a factor between a multiplier between overconsolidation pressure and current a current stress level. I wonder if people are getting back. Well, I see one more question that I will do, and I've seen it passing a couple of times, is that people say, well, in plexus you can model something in plane strain and you can model something in axisymmetry. What is axisymmetry? In plane strain, what you I don't know how much you are into baking. It sounds like a strange question, but plane strain is that you have a very long cake, and then you just cut a slice out of the cake. So that slice, I mean, where you cut the slice doesn't matter, because the cross-section area of that very long rectangular cake is the same everywhere. So you can cut the slice anywhere you like, because the cross-section doesn't change. That is a plane strain model. An axisymmetry model is more when you buy a pie, which is a round pie. You can cut a piece out of the pie, which is like, well, almost a triangular, because one side of the triangle is then the curved outside of your pie. And that is an axisymmetry model. So you model something that in circular direction doesn't change. For instance, you could use that if you want to model a round circular shaft with depth or a single pile with an axial load. Then you can model a cylinder of soil with your pile in the middle and put an axial load on it. Those cases use an axisymmetric model. Practically speaking, the vast majority of the models that we use are plane strain models and not axisymmetry models. So axisymmetry models are for very specific cases. Single pile and shaft are the most common ones. Well, I will also look at my colleagues. Shall we continue?
I think we can continue. Yeah, sure.
So I hope that everybody, let's say, got their little necessary break. Now, if in the flow conditions mode and in the stage construction mode, we're going to define the different phases necessary to model the construction process of our project. What we have to start with is what we call the initial phase. And in the initial phase, we first have to define the initial stresses in the soil and the initial pore pressures in the soil. So that is the stress state that is there before anything is being built at all. That is the initial stage of our project. And those initial pore pressures and initial stresses can be calculated in different ways. One of this is the K-knot procedure. We will talk later on Wednesday about a factor K-knot. We start with a situation where the soil has no weight, and then we slowly switch on the weight of the soil, and that should bring stresses into the soil, and then we end up with the full weight of the soil being applied. So it's like we start with a situation that we have no gravity, our construction is somewhere in space, and we will slowly bring it to Earth. So the closer we get to Earth, the more gravity it's involved, and when it's down on Earth, then the full gravity of the soil is the full gravity of Earth is applied. So that is why we call it gravity loading. The third option is field stress. And in field stress, we just directly input values of horizontal stress and vertical stress. Horizontal stress, two components, sigma x and sigma z, sigma y for the vertical stress, and it's inputted directly. This can be, for instance, used if you want to make some a tunnel in very deep rock. We don't want to model everything, I mean, all the rock until the surface, including the whole mountain. We just want to put direct input of the stresses of a confined piece of rock. Then you use the field stress option. And then the last option is flow only. Now, if we use the flow only option, then we're not going to generate any effective soil stresses. We only will generate water pressures. If you choose the flow only option as your initial phase of your calculation, then later on, you can only do groundwater flow analysis. No deformation, no stability, no soil stresses, only pore pressures. So you can use black axis as a hydrological. The first three will generate you effective stresses in the soil. The last option will only generate your pore pressures, and therefore you can only do a calculation in terms of pore pressures. So this is the choice that you have to make already in the initial initial part. Then after the initial phase, we calculate more construction phases.
It was the 37th pick in the 2014 NBA draft. So my question to you is,
or listen to the daily news from around the wide world of college football with College Football Live.
I would go with Utah. I think Utah is the better team. And I know I'm talking to an Oklahoma guy, but listen, and it may be recency bias having watched Utah last week and doing that game, but I just think they're a more complete football.
Discover these and more college sports podcasts right here on TuneIn.
Perfectly undrained is the opposite. We assume that the water cannot go anywhere, so any load I put on my soil will immediately lead to excess pore pressures and really like full excess pore pressures. Now, the second option is when you're in between, that is consolidation. So consolidation is time-dependent generation and dissipation of pore pressures. So that one, for instance, you use if you say, well, it's not perfectly drained, it's not perfectly undrained, it's somewhere in between. I'm going to construct an embankment. It will take me some time. In that time, the pore pressures go up because of the construction of my embankment, but it will also dissipate because time will pass. So I have a combination of the two. This is a typical consolidation analysis. You could also say, well, my construction is quite fast. I do it plastic, perfectly undrained, and then I just let it consolidate for 30 days. So I don't construct during consolidation. I just let it rest to get rid of pore pressures. Then we have fully coupled flow deformation analysis. Now, consolidation analysis only takes into account consolidation because of undrained effects. It could be that while generating excess pore pressures because of loading, you also have varying water loads, water levels in time. Could have many reasons. You're pumping water out of your project area. You're working with a dam and the water level in the lake behind the dam is varying due to the time that you're working on your project. In this case, to take into account a fully coupled analysis that takes into account deformations, consolidation, transient groundwater flow. It could even take into account thermal flow if you want to. That all together in one calculation is what we call a fully coupled flow deformation analysis. We have a dynamics analysis. If you have time-dependent loads, it could be used for seismic analysis, but it can also be a dynamics analysis because of a traffic load or construction works. But you can specify that your load changes in time. It can be harmonic, it can be an earthquake file, that can be just a table you specify yourself for how the load varies in time. And then we have a safety analysis, and a safety analysis is to determine a factor of safety at a certain stage at your construction process. How this exactly works, we will also see later in this course. And then you have two more options that only are available when the initial phase was chosen as flow only, and that is steady state groundwater flow. So you generate a groundwater flow field that is just fixed, constant in time. Or you do a transient groundwater flow analysis, in which case you also have to specify a time, and then you can take into account a varying groundwater flow field in time. And those two options are the only calculation options if you do a flow only analysis. So the first five options would then not be be available. So initial conditions, we talked about it when we said something about initial stresses. We have to distinguish a little bit what exactly is the initial situation. First of all, we have to split this in initial water conditions and initial geometry. Initial water conditions, you have to specify in your flow conditions mode where is the initial phreatic level. Maybe initially you already want to do a groundwater flow analysis because you're going to make a building that is on the slope of a hill, and the hill already has a groundwater flow field inside, and you want to be able to model that. So that is part one, your initial pore pressure distribution that you do in the flow conditions mode. And then in the stage construction mode, you do your initial geometry configuration. So you have to make sure that things that are initially there should be activated. So if you're going to make an excavation, of course, all the soil inside your excavation is initially there, so it has to be activated. On the other hand, the walls and the anchors of your excavation are initially not there. We're going to construct them as part of our project. So those have to be deactivated. Also, if you want to make an embankment or a dam, the soil of that embankment and dam initially has to be deactivated because we're going to construct it. Initially, it's not there yet. And then we generate the initial stresses based, well, usually using K-naught or gravity loading, but you may have to use a field stress for your specific problem. And after we have specified that initially, we specify the construction phases. What can we do in construction phases? We can activate or deactivate soil. We can activate or deactivate structural elements and pre-stress anchors, change materials for soil. If you want to do a soil improvement, you may want to change your soil for another soil that has the properties of the improved soil. We can apply loads, change the values of loads, prescribe displacements. We can apply volume strains if you want to model an expansion of your soil or expansion because you're inserting a grout or something. Applying a tunnel contraction. You can change groundwater levels, you can change ground temperature. So a lot of things can be changed, and they can be changed for every next phase again. So how do we do that? You can select the area where you want to make the change. Then you can either right click on it, and then in the menu, that the right mouse button menu that appears, you can activate, deactivate, or make changes. If you click it, it will also appear in the selection explorer. So only in the selection explorer, you see the parts that you just selected. So there you can make the changes. You can click on the line load part of the selected object and then change the value of the line load. Or you just can look it up directly in the model explorer. Now the model explorer, of course, contains the whole model. So finding your specific piece of soil in the model explorer can be quite a bit of work if your model is quite large. So changing it directly in the model explorer is less common, but can be done if you want to. About the calculation itself, if you are in stage construction mode, then you will get on your top left, you will get an extra little window there, which is referred to as the phase explorer. And in the phase explorer, you can see the list of all the calculation phases that you have been creating so far. And here we have a little example in the middle. So we have an initial phase, and then we have phases 1, 2, 3, 4. And you can, well, first of all, you see that it has a bit of a tree shape. So you can already see from how it's being presented in the phase explorer, what is the order of what is the construction order of your project. Now, then on top of that, you have a couple of buttons. If you want to add a construction phase, or you want to insert one, or you want to delete one, you have a button that gives you additional settings for the phase, and that is quite a list of settings we will see in the next slide. you have a little icon in front of your face that can have different colors. If it's just gray, that means that the face is there, it's not active. You can have a blue icon with a little arrow in it. That means that that face is selected to be calculated. So when you press the calculate button, that face will be calculated. If it has a green icon with a check mark in front of it, it means it was calculated and it was calculated successfully. Successfully here simply means that whatever you wanted to change has been calculated. It doesn't say anything about whether the result is good or bad or safe or unsafe. That is a different thing. It just said that it was able to calculate the changes that you as a user wanted to make. And then you can have a red icon with a cross in it, and in that case, the calculation failed. That can have different reasons. It could be that you try to apply a load that was far bigger than the failure load. So it said, well, sorry, it failed because you wanted to apply a 500 kPa load, and after 100 kPa, I had a failure mechanism, so it's not possible. Occasionally, it can be a numerical problem related to meshing, but most of the times, if the calculation fails, it's simply because there is a really soil body failure. You either have a slip surface, or you try to apply a load higher than the bearing capacity, something like that. Now, on the right side of your faces, you have a small list of icons, actually three columns. The first one, I would say, is the most important one. The first one gives an idea about what kind of calculation that is. So for the first initial phase, you can see a little icon that says whether it has a K-naught procedure or gravity loading for initial stresses. For other phases, we have separate icons, whether it's a plastic phase, a dynamics, a consolidation, a fully coupled, a safety analysis, just to give you a first idea what kind of calculation that is. Well, the second column gives the way it's being loaded, and that is not so interesting. And the third column actually gives how pore pressures are being handled. So we have an icon there that says that you used phreatic levels, or that you used groundwater flow, or one that has an arrow, and you can see that from the phases 2, 3, and 4. It has an arrow pointing down. That just means that I didn't generate pore pressures in this phase. I just took them from the phase before, which basically means that there was no change in pore pressures between from phase 1 to 2, 3, and 4. So it just copies the pore pressure resulting from phase 1 into 2, 3, and 4. And of course, you as a user can determine whether you want to generate new pore pressures, just copy them, do a groundwater flow analysis. That is up to you to decide. I already promised to show the phases window. Well, this is it, and actually we can scroll even more. So per phase, we can set a lot of different things. We can indicate whether what calculation type should be, whether we should specify a certain time. If it's a consolidation phase, we have to specify a consolidation time that can be specified here. And there are a lot more settings that we can do. So we can temporarily consider soil not to be an undrained material if we want to. There's quite a list of settings. Some of them are more related to deformation analysis. Some of them are very numerical, and then we try to touch them as little as possible. So that are all the settings you can do per phase. A couple of the most important: start from phase, in which case you can change the order of your calculation phase. Let's say you have three phases, a phase 1 and a phase 2 and 3. And 2 and 3 should both start from phase 1, because 2 and 3 are two alternatives of the same project. And you put in the phases and you say, well, phase 2 starts from 1 and 3 starts from 2. So you have a linear list. That is not what you wanted. Then you can change for phase 3 that it should not start from 2, but it should start from 1, and change that. Reset displacements to 0. This one actually, well, as the name said, resets all the displacements that were achieved until now. That can, for instance, be done because you first have to do a couple of calculation phases to model something that was already there, and which is not, you want it to be there, but you don't care about the deformations that that caused. So you want to get rid of those deformations and only have deformations related to your project only. Ignore undrained behavior. As I said, you can temporarily say that for this specific phase, undrained material should be temporarily considered undrained. That could be practical for gravity loading, but also if you're only interested in long-term solution. And of course, the time interval. This gives you a construction time. For consolidation, this is necessary. For dynamics, this is necessary. But also if you have time-dependent soil behavior, if you want to calculate with creep, you also have to indicate a certain amount of creep time. So then you have to specify a time interval. If you try to do those calculations without specifying a time interval, you will actually get a message about it that says, hey, I mean, for this type of analysis, you do have to specify a time interval. Now, then we press the calculate button. It will do the calculation for you. And then, of course, we're going to be able to see some output. Now, this is just an example picture of output. In this case, we see displacements for an excavation. These are total displacements. So you can see from the color, the level of displacements. So you have on the right side, you have a legend with what color represents what level of displacement. And there are many more options of output that we can see. You have graphical output, you have table output. You can see it from displacements. We separate total displacements, phase displacements, and incremental displacements. What is the difference? Total displacements are all the displacements summed up until now. The phase displacement is only the change of displacements that happened in the current phase that I'm looking on. Let's say I have a project of 10 phases. I'm looking in phase 4. Then the total displacement of phase 4 is the sum of displacements from phases 1, 2, 3, 4 altogether. The phase displacement is only the change of displacements in phase 4, which is the one I'm looking at. Now, when we do something in a phase, we can usually not apply the changes in one go. We have to do that in small steps. The incremental displacement is the change of displacements in the last little load step I took in that phase. So for all the increments of a certain phase together make the phase displacements, and all the phases together then make the total displacement. We can see absolute displacements, so really like as vectors. We can see the horizontal or the vertical component of it. We can plot them as arrows, as contour lines, as contour colors is also a possibility. We can do it for stresses. Stresses, you can see effective stresses. You can see total stresses. You can see pore pressures, the total pore pressures, or just the excess pore pressure, or maybe only the steady state pore pressure. Stresses can be seen as Cartesian stresses, so sigma X and sigma Y. You can see mean effective stresses or mean total stresses. You can see deviatoric stresses. And you have plots of principal stresses where you can see as crosses the direction and the size of principal stresses. You can also use them as contour lines or contour shadings. Now, almost all those options that are available for stresses are also available for strains. So we have total strains, phase strains, incremental strains, just like we have for displacements. You have Cartesian volume, Cartesian strains, so epsilon X, epsilon Y, volume strains, shear strains, plots with principal strains. That is all possible. You can do a couple of more. You have groundwater flow results, thermal flow results, dynamics analysis results, velocities, accelerations in the soil. You can see structural forces. So if you have a plate element, you can see axial forces, shear forces, hoop forces. We can make a cross section so that you can see displacements in a cross section, for instance. On top of that, you can do a report generator. So if you need a lot of certain plots, you don't have to show them one by one and make a screenshot. In the report generator, you can say for which calculation phases you want to see which plots. You press on a button on the end and it will generate all those pictures, all those tables for you in the background and save them. And you have an option to make animations, which of course is very, well, it's big fun, of course, to see that for a dynamics analysis, to see a building moving. But of course, it also gives you great insight in movement. structural forces. How do we do that? Well, you have two buttons in output. One to select an individual structural element. If you do that, you can select multiple using the shift, control, and alt keys in the right way. If you hang your mouse over the button, it will tell you how that exactly works. Then you can select a single element or a group of elements. You can also use the second button. Then you just drag an area. And then it selects all the structural elements that are inside that area. If there are different kinds in there, let's say there are plates and anchors, it will ask you, do you want to select all the plates in the area or all the anchors in the area? And you can choose. And then it will open a new window. And in the new window, you can then see the results of the structural element. We throw in a poll in between. So I hope you have been following what I've been trying to tell you. And that is, the poll is, if you want to generate the initial soil stresses, what options are there available in Plexus? So now, again, you have four options. Please answer the poll. I mean, you can send it on the chat, but it will not be taken into account in the statistics. Please answer the poll what you think is the correct answer here. Which ways do we have in Plexus to generate the initial soil stresses as a start of the calculation? So what does the window of structural forces look like? Well, it opens a new window, as already mentioned. You will see the structural element that you chose. In this case, you see we have a vertical wall, and we see bending moments here. You will have some extra menu options at the top where you can choose what structural force to see, the axial force, the shear force, the bending moment. If it's in 3D, you can even see torsions and things like that. You can apply a scale factor, so how big or small are the bending moments being drawn. You have a scale bar on the right side that tells you what the current scale is of the structural forces. And in the title bar at the bottom, it also gives you what the minimum and maximum structural force is that you can currently see in your plot. So then you don't have to go into a table to find the minimum and maximum. If that is your interest, you can see it straight away from the title bar underneath. You can also make a cross section, and the button you can see here. You can just directly draw it. If you choose the cross section button, it will also open a small window, and in that small window, you can enter the coordinates of the start and the end point. If you do so, please don't touch your mouse, because as soon as you touch your mouse, it will actually use your mouse coordinates again to use the cross section, and then you lose what you just typed in. So at the moment you decide to type them, click on the window, don't touch the mouse, just enter the coordinates and change with the tab key between the fields and press OK. And then it will open a new window showing you the cross section with the results. Now, this is the result of the poll. Now, it's clear that you're all paying very well attention, because indeed option B is the possibility. Soil stresses cannot be generated with flow only, because flow only generates your pore pressures. You can do cannot proceed with gravity loading and field stresses. I do understand that people didn't include field stresses, because field stresses, you could first say, you don't really generate them, you enter them directly. But you do have soil stresses as well, but flow only mode doesn't. So option one and four, that option one that includes flow only, sorry, but you cannot generate soil stresses, only pore pressures, and so answer B was the most correct answer here. This is what a cross-section window looks like. You see the cross-section again on the top menu. You can choose what you actually want to see in the cross-section: displacements, stresses, strains. That can all be changed. You can enter a scale factor to make it to blow up the picture a little bit. You have again the scale next to it in the legend, and you have the minimum and maximum value in the title. Now this ends, let's say, the possibilities that we have for input for the stage flow conditions and stage construction mode, as well as for as well as for the output program. So now we should continue on the exercise. And so I will do an attempt to share my my screen here. And so I hope it is visible. I'm also I'm checking whether my colleagues are mentioned, whether they can see it. Okay, it's a little bit slow, but I think it's possible to see it. So here we have the mesh modes that we already did. So the mesh has been generated here. So here we are on the top. So now we go to the flow conditions the flow conditions mode. So this is what the flow conditions mode look like. Well, as you can see, we have one water level, which is called global. This is based on that head value that we filled in the borehole. And remember, we filled in a head that was plus 4 meters. This was the only thing we filled in the borehole. So this plus 4 meters translate into one water level, the global water level automatically at plus 4 meters. If you would click on it, then we would also see in the selection explorer that it's called borehole water level one. It comes out of the borehole, and it's the only water level we have, so it obviously gets number one. You also see the color here change to green. What does that mean? Well, what has been built in is that if you select a certain water level, then all the soil that has that water level assigned will be then drawn in green. So that is what happened here. So now I have no water level selected. And if I select the global water level and I wonder what soil all uses the global water level, I can just select the global water level like this. And if I do that, then you see that all the soil that has the global water level assigned becomes green. You can also do it the opposite way. If you have, so let me make it back to blue again. And now you're wondering, my soil layer, what water level does it actually use? Well, if I want to know, I just select the soil layer. It becomes red, the soil layer. But what I also see, and that is the most important, is that my global water level now became green. So if I select a certain soil layer in flow conditions mode, then I can see what water level this soil piece uses, because that water level becomes green then. So you can always see which water level is linked to what soil by either selecting the water level and see all the soils that have this water level, or by selecting the soil and see what water level was assigned to that soil. So that is, we could use more functionality. We don't need it here. We have on the button bar, for instance, the option to create more water levels, but for this specific exercise, we don't need this. So we're going straight to a stage construction mode. So that is where we are now. We see on the top left, we see the phases explorer. So we only have one here now, which is the initial phase that we have here. And in the initial phase, we have to define what is the initial situation of our soil. Well, the initial situation is that we have only the soil. We don't have a footing. And we don't have a load. Well, this is also what Plexus gives you as the initial situation, because initially Plexus says, well, so we don't have to make any changes to this. We can already see from the first icon after the initial phase that K-NOT procedure here has been chosen. If you would like to change that, again, we're not going to do that here. What you could do is that you could double click on the face. So I do that here. And if you double click on the face, then the window will appear with all the face settings. And first is the name. And then secondly, it says calculation type K-NOT procedure. If you would like to change that, then you can open the list here. And if you open the list here, then you see the other options and you could choose one of the other options. Again, we're not going to do that here, but I just wanted to show you where to choose this. Now, in this case, we are going to construct our footing and then apply our load. So I will add a face here. So I will, in the Faces Explorer, click on the add button here. Then now I will get a phase one that is here defined. You could just leave it with the name phase one if you want to. You could also decide to give it a name. If you want to give it a name, you double click on it. And if you double click it, hey, you have the phases list, and you give it some name here, create a footing or something like that. You just fill it in. You close it, and now your phase is called create footing. In this phase, as the name already says, we're going to create the footing. So the footing area is the area here on top of the soil. So I can select it. And now we have a couple of possibilities how to handle it. I can right click. And if I right click, then you see that the second option here in the menu is activate. So that would be one option to deal with it. I can also go to the selection explorer, and there I see my polygon that I just selected. The first option underneath is soil _2_1. This is the area of soil I just selected. If I would click on that little check mark in front of it, I would also select it. I will now just use the activate option from the menu. So I will select it. Now it's in red. You can also see now that in your selection explorer, you see the check mark in front of the soil to indicate that it has been activated. Now it's red now because it's selected. If I would click somewhere outside my model, then the selection is gone, and then I will see it will become green because now it's green to in, and that is the color of the concrete material that I once assigned. Now we don't have to do anything more to it than just this. So now we want to apply the load to it as well. So we're going to apply a load of minus 50 kPa. So I create a new phase. I will add it. I will already give it give it a name. So okay, that was maybe a little bit fast. So now we have a phase. Phase two follows directly on phase one. We can also see that from the little tree structure there. Apply vertical load. I do that by selecting the load. The load is now gray. If I click on it, then it becomes red because I select it. Again, I could use the right mouse button. Here, I will just use the selection explorer. So I have in the selection explorer, I just calculated on 0.11. That has the property that it's also a point load. I will check mark it so that we will see that we have a point load now. And then I will fill in a vertical a value of minus 50 because I want it to point downwards. So it has to be minus 50. Otherwise, if I do plus 50, it will be pointing upwards because the positive Y is upwards. So a positive value of the load is then also pointing, pointing upwards. So I fill in minus 50 here. Now, if I again click outside my area, it's a bit difficult to see, but the load now is blue. So when it was gray, it was inactive, and now it's blue because it's active. But I have to admit, especially on a laptop, the difference between gray and blue can be rather subtle. So now we applied the vertical load. And now I'm interested in two different cases. I'm interested what would happen if, for instance, this vertical load represents the weight of a small building here on top. And what if there would be a very strong wind, and that wind will blow against my building and therefore also cause a horizontal load on my footing. So that is the first case I'm interested in. What if I would have a horizontal load? And the second is okay, I have a vertical load of 50 kPa, but how much vertical load can it actually handle? 100, 200, 500, 1000 maybe? So I'm also interested in what would be the maximum vertical load here. So I want to calculate both of them. And of course, I don't want to do that in two different projects. I want to do it in the same project. So we first do the case number one. So I will again add another construction phase here. So I do add phase. I will give it again a name. I will say apply horizontal load. So I do this. Horizontal load follows on vertical load. Now what you see is that in phase three, it made a copy of phase two. So the footing is still there. The vertical load, of course, is also still there. So it's not that I have to redefine them. It just said, well, if phase three follows on phase two, I will just start with making a copy of phase two. So as a start for phase three. I want to apply a horizontal load. I do not want to apply only a horizontal load. I want to apply a horizontal load together with the vertical load that represents the weight of my building. So I will again select my my load here. You can see it's still activated. It still has a vertical value of minus 50. I will now add a horizontal component of 20. And of course, now you can also see that my load is getting inclined because it has a vertical component of 50 and a horizontal component of 20. So the total load being applied is horizontal. So this is my building with a horizontal load representing, for instance, a wind force. So this is case one I was interested in. And case two is what will be my vertical failure load. Now, I don't want to have my vertical failure load following up on applying the horizontal load. I just want to have my vertical failure load as a separate case. So my vertical failure load should not start from phase three because phase three have the horizontal load. Of course, I could switch it off, but I want to have it following phase two so that phase three and four are two alternative calculations. So what I can do is that I can select phase two here in my list. And then I say again, add phase. And because I first selected phase two, phase four will now automatically follow from phase two and not from phase three. So I will again give it a name. I will just call it failure load. Now, if I would have made a mistake here, I could still here in start from phase, I could have selected that it should start from phase two. So if I made a mistake and my phase four would have started from phase three, I could have still here changed that if I want to. So I have my phase four now, and you can also nicely see in the tree that I have a phase three and I have a phase four, and they clearly both follow from phase two. So they're like two constructions here. So, well, my load was still selected. It starts from phase two, so it made a copy of phase two. So you can see that I have the minus 50 here already included. Now, I don't know how much the failure load is. That is something I want to calculate. I just say, well, then try to apply minus 500 and we will see how far we actually get. So this finishes the definition of my calculation phases. Now I may want to see at some point that I want to see a displacements in as a time history or something like that, in which case I could select a certain point. To do so, we have a button here, and with this button I can pre-select a couple of points, and when I do so, it will just lock all the data during the calculations for those points, so that I later can make a load displacement curve of a time history or something like that. So if I press on it, it will start the it will start the output program. So that should be visible anytime soon. Yes, here it is. Now, let's pick a point that is directly underneath my footing. So I will zoom in a little bit on the footing. And then I will just pick a point here. I just click on it. You now also see that in the little list I have on the right side, it says so. It's node 752 and the coordinates where it's being located. So this node, it will just log all the data during the calculation so that I later can make some kind of curve out of this. Now, if you select points, and you can select as many as you want. Here I select a node. You could also select a stress point if you want to have a stress strain history. Nodes are for load displacement histories. If you have selected the point, don't just close output, because then you lose your selection. You have to go to the top left, and there is a button that is called update, which is the green one, and that one you have to use, because then it will actually save the choice of this point. If you go to the top right and click on the cross, then it won't save it. You will lose it. So I now selected this point, and then I can start the calculation, which is this button here. I have no idea what the calculation would look like, considering it's a little bit slow in sending data. So I run the calculation. This is a very small project. So of course, calculation will be quite fast. Now what we see is that calculations 1, 2, and 3 were calculated successfully. Calculation 4, it fails because I have the red cross. I'm not entirely surprised because I want to calculate the failure load. I had no idea how much the failure load is, so I just gave it a very big value, 500. So it's very well possible that that 500 was not possible. I could even see, because if I double click on it, then it opens the settings again. And now if you look in the settings on the top right, you see log info for last calculation, which is now the phase 4, and it says soil body seems to collapse. So that already gives an indicator that Plexi thinks this is just a soil failure problem here. And that could indeed very well be the case. I see that something is sending me messages now. Sorry about that. So Plexi already thinks that the soil body is probably doing a collapse, but it suggests me to check output to have a look at it. So, okay, let's do that. I will start. I will select the initial phase. Then I will go to calculation results here, which is this option here. It will again start my output program. Now you also see that some parts of the window take quite a bit of space. So to reduce that a little bit, I will remove the whole command line section here at the bottom, so I have a little bit more space to handle. So this is the result of my initial phase. Well, not very exciting. It also says that it's a deformed mesh and it has a uniform value of 0 meters. I don't have any deformation here yet. Then I will I can choose up here. I have a drop-down list, and with this drop-down list, I can choose other phases. So let's say what happens after creating the footing. So this is when I created the footing. You see the deformed mesh. Well, the soil went down a bit. You can see for the bottom how much it went down. So it went down about this is 2 millimeters or something like that. It looks very impressive. But please look also at the title. It says deformed mesh scaled up 200 times. So the deformations you see on the screen are 200 times bigger than the real deformation. If you say I want to see the real deformation, we have up here, we have a button that is called scale factor. And if you click that, you can actually set the scale factor. And one of the options here is true scale. So that is the first option here. If you choose a true scale and you click OK, now you actually don't really see settlements because you have something big that is settling 2 millimeters. So you don't see much, but this is, of course, the realistic scaling. Let's change back to auto scale again. So this is the settlement of the footing. Now we had the two options. We have we first apply the vertical load. It will settle a little bit more. Now what you can also see, which is interesting, is that you see this, it settles a bit more, but it also has a slight tilt. The left side is a little bit large, has a little bit more settlement than the right side. This is because the mesh is rather coarse. So the geometry is perfectly symmetric, so you would expect it to go down nicer vertical. But because the mesh elements underneath are not perfectly symmetric, the mesh is a little bit different underneath the left side and under the right side of the model. Therefore, it has a little bit of a tilt. If you make a finer mesh, you will get rid of the tilt again. So this is applying the vertical load. Here we apply the horizontal load together with it. So now, of course, we see, I can zoom in a little bit, that we also have a horizontal movement and a tilt. Now, it looks like we have less settlements, but that is because the scale factor changed. Now you can see it scaled up 20 times, and if I looked at the previous one, then it scaled up 50 times. So now it looks like I have less settlements, but that is not true. We could fixate the scale factor by using here on the this little lock here. If I click it, then I will lock the scale factor, and now if I go down, I maintain the 50 kPa scale factor. So now we see we still have the same settlements, but now it moves a bit to the right and I have a tilt. And then of course we have the one that we wanted to push it to failure. Now if I push it to failure, of course my scale factor of 50 is going to be way too big, so I will just move back to auto scale again. And then, of course, I have to release it. So now it's only scaled 5 times. And now you see that at failure, it has a settlement of something like 12 centimeters. So and this is my failure situation. Now, this is just default mesh. I could, for instance, look at things like total displacements. I mean, that could be an interesting one to have a look at. So this is in colors, my total displacement at failure. I could also have a look at the arrows, for instance. So here you see the arrows. So you see that underneath the soil is being pushed down and then also being pushed away horizontally. Here you see on the left and the right, you see arrows going outward. So the soil that is being pushed down is also moving out horizontally. I can have a look at stresses, for instance. So here I have all the stress options. So let's say principal effective stresses. If I look at that one, then now my biggest stresses are here in my concrete plate. So in my soil, the stresses are so small compared to the concrete that I don't really see that much. I mean, you have an option to switch that off to get rid of that. Oh, then of course I have to find. So I have settings. And then results. So in this step sheet shows stress for non-porous material. Well, concrete is a non-porous material. I switch that off. And now it does not take into account the stresses in my concrete, which are very big. It only takes into account for drawing the stresses in my soil. And now, of course, I see what is happening. Otherwise, the stresses in your concrete are so big that whatever happens in the soil is almost impossible. So I see here my principal stresses. Well, they have increased underneath my plate, which makes sense. That is where my load is. You can also see that far away from the model here, not much has happened. So, I mean, they're pretty much still the stresses that I had from horizontal and vertical, not much rotations. I do see that my horizontal stresses increased here. And why did they increase? Well, because I pushed out the soil sideways. And because I pushed out the soil, I have an increase of horizontal stresses. So this gives you a bit of idea what happens with the stresses in the soil. Now, of course, one question that we didn't answer yet is, okay, I applied 500 kPa, it failed, but what is my failure load now? Now, to do so, I will draw a graph, and I will draw a graph of the applied load during the calculation. So I go to my curves manager here, and I'm waiting for it to show up. Yes, there it is. I don't have any curves, any charge right now defined. So I will define a new one. So then it will create me my curve generation window. On the x-axis, what shall we put there? Well, we can put, for instance, displacement of the point that we were interested in. I can also choose the step number of the calculation. But okay, let's say I will put a displacement here. So I choose the node that was underneath to get the point from. Then I have to say what exactly I want to see in that point. I want to see deformations, let's say total displacements, the vertical one, for instance. Now, on my vertical axis, I want to see the applied load. The problem is a little bit is that we don't have a parameter directly for applied load, but we have one that is called applied load, but that is a very general parameter that just says if nothing has been done, it's 0%. And if it has been fully applied, it's 100%. And that parameter is called a multiplier and it's called sigma M stage. And M stage stands for stage construction. So it's the stage construction indicator, how far it went. And I will just plot that one. Well, my displacements are negative, so the curve is turned the other way around. So my calculation starts on the right and then moves to the left. I can change that by saying that I want to have a horizontal flip of my curve. So I pressed F3, then you get the curve settings. You could also have right-clicked on the curve. I say, well, flip horizontal, and then it looks like this. Now, what you see here may be a bit confusing, but I see here for all the phases, on my vertical axis, I have an indicator that the change I wanted to apply that has to go from 0, no change applied yet, to 1, 100%, the chain should be fully applied. So this is construction of the footing is the most left one, which is this one here. Then I have the application of the horizontal, vertical load, horizontal load. But the branch I'm mostly interested in is this one here. Try to hang my mouse over it so that you can see the window. This is the one I'm interested here because this is the last phase I calculated. I got my pop-up so briefly that you probably didn't see it. Yes, now you do. So this is the branch that I'm interested in. And what you can see is that the final value that it reached is just below 40%. Because it's a little bit less than 0.4. What does that mean? Well, that 40% of the load I wanted to apply was actually applied. But what did I want to apply? Well, remember, we started this phase when we already had a vertical load of 50 kilopascal. We wanted to move it to 500. So we applied 450 kilopascal. The 500 is the final value minus the 50 that we started with. So we applied 450 kilopascal, and out of that 450 kilopascal, about 40% was applied. Now, 40% out of 450 is about 180 kilopascal. I already had 50 in the beginning. 180 was applied plus the 50 I already had, 230 kilopascal. So my failure load is somewhere in the order of 230 kilopascal here. So it doesn't give you the value directly, but you can deduct it from the curve that you have been drawing here. And if you would compare this to bearing capacity loads according to Brinshansen or Meyerhof or Vesic, you will find very similar values here. So this is the failure load that we have been calculating here. So this is very briefly this exercise that I wanted to explain. And so this is just a demo, and now we used here concrete elements for a plate, and some people have already been asking why did you didn't use a plate element, but why did you use this concrete elements? Well, we didn't discuss plate elements yet, and that is actually something that I'm going to do right now. So now I will move into discussion of structural elements to show you that there are also other ways than just using a plate element. So we move a little bit into not just using soil inside in my model, but also being able to use different kinds of models. So we're back in presentation now. What kind of structural elements do we have in Plexus? Because I cannot always use soil. In this case, I could. I had a plate in my exercise. I used the soil. But if I have a very thin wall or I have an anchor or a grout body, it's not so easy to use soil. So therefore, we have a couple of structural elements in Plexus. We have plate elements. We have two different kinds of anchors. We have geogrids. We have embedded beam rows. And then we have interfaces. And I know there have been some questions already on interfaces, so I hope I can clear that up in this presentation. What can you use them for? Geotextile, reinforced walls, anchored walls, cofferdams, struts, ground anchors, pile foundations. Those are all possibilities that you can use structural elements for. Yes, so let's discuss them briefly, one by one. No, first, plate elements. Plate elements are just one-dimensional line elements. They have either three nodes or five nodes. That is not a direct choice. That depends on the soil elements. I've drawn two soil elements here in green, a six-noded soil element and a 50-noded soil element. A plate element follows the sides of soil elements. So if I have six-noded soil elements, my plate element, which is here drawn in blue, automatically gets three nodes. If I use a 15-noded soil element, my plate element automatically gets five nodes. Every node has 3 degrees of freedom. So in every node, we calculate horizontal displacement, vertical displacement, and the rotation. The rotation, of course, we need to be able to calculate things like bending moments. And then for every plate, we calculate axial forces, shear forces, bending moments. And if you use an axisymmetric model, you can also calculate hoop forces. So those are like ring forces. The plate can have elastic behavior. It can also have elastoplastic behavior. That is what we have to specify when we specify a material for the plate. So just like for soil, where we have to specify materials, we also have to do this for plate elements. So this is the kind of things that we have to specify as plate materials. Of course, we don't have to specify cohesion and friction angle and things like that. It has its own material set in which you specify a bending stiffness, EI, and axial stiffness, EA. And they are calculated simply by the elasticity modulus of the material and the moment of inertia. Well, a plate element is a one-dimensional element, so it's assumed to have a rectangular cross-section. So the moment of inertia is then divided as 1/12 times the out-of-plane distance times the thickness to the power 3. Well, this is a plane strain model. That means that the out-of-plane width of the element is 1 meter by definition in a plane strain model. So it's in principle the moment of inertia is 1/12 times the thickness to the power 3. The axial stiffness is calculated in a similar way. Those are the parameters you have to enter. Plexis calculates based on EI and EA an element thickness. That is not something you do as a user. Plexis does it for you. It shows it in the window and it gives you a bit of a control. So it says, okay, based on this bending stiffness and axial stiffness, the element should have this thickness. If your element really is rectangular, this value is accurate. If you have an element that has actually in reality is irregular, sheet pi wall, it should be in the same order. If you fill in data and element thickness says that it's 5 nanometers or 3 kilometers, you did something wrong in the input. A typo or a table that works with different units. So it's a control parameter. And then on top of this, we can also specify additional parameters, like for instance, the weight and the kind of behavior. For the kind of behavior, you can choose it to be elastic, then nothing more has to be entered. You can say that it's linear elastic, perfectly plastic, in which case you can specify a maximum full bending plastic moment and a maximum full plastic axial force. And then Plexis says, well, if you look on the axis in the graph, you have a bending moment, the horizontal axis, and axial force on the vertical axis. Then you see you have the full plastic bending moment for pure bending and the full axial plastic force for full axial only axial force. Those are the maximum values. And if you have a combination of the two, then your combination of bending moment and axial force has to fall within this red rectangle. So if it falls outside, Plexis will top it off and create large plastic strains, and you will probably get some kind of a plastic hinge in your plate element. There are a couple of other combinations. You can do it a bit more complicated, where you specify an M kappa diagram. So here you really specify bending moment as function of the curvature of your plate element. So then you can model, let's say, not perfect perfect elastoplasticity, but really like you have reduction of the bending stiffness with increasing curvature. You specify that through a certain table, so you specify branches 1, 2, and 3, for instance, through the table. If you would then unload, then it will follow the table again for the unloading behavior, and you would actually create even some kind of hysteretic unloading, reloading behavior in your plate element. I don't have a slide double somehow. Other parameters are there. One is prevent punching, because a plate element is a one-dimensional element. It has no real thickness in there. That means that if you would put a vertical load on it, it would actually very easily cut through the soil, like a knife cutting in butter or something like that. And that sometimes means that you get a very excessive vertical displacement that is not realistic, because in reality your wall has a certain thickness. Then we have the option prevent punching. If you switch it on, then it will actually create underneath your wall a small elastic zone that prevents your wall to actually cut through the soil downwards. So that is purely because otherwise, if you wouldn't do that, you will probably get a very local soil failure because of the high vertical displacements of your wall. And that soil failure is not realistic. So that is why you have the option prevent punching. You can specify, if you do a dynamics analysis, damping parameters, Rayleigh alpha, Rayleigh beta. And if you do a thermal analysis, you have a couple of thermal parameters that you could also define that we will just for now leave for what it is. Weight is also something that have to be put in. Here it becomes important that your plate element in reality has no thickness, because in your model has no thickness, and in reality, of course, you model something that does have a thickness. So let's say you have some kind of floor here that is a concrete floor with a certain thickness, let's say 25 centimeters. In my model, this becomes a plate element that has no thickness at all. So this 25 centimeters thickness that in reality is filled with concrete, in my model is just filled with soil, because my plate element is not taking that space. It has no thickness. That means that if I would put the weight of my floor, my concrete floor, completely in my plate element, is that in what is the dotted area in my model, in this picture, in that dotted area, I have the weight of the soil and all the weight of the concrete. And that is too much weight. So what you usually do is that you put the additional weight. So you say, well, my concrete, my floor in concrete has this weight, in soil it has the other weight, and the difference between the two, I put in the plate. So I put the incremental weight between soil and concrete, in this case, in my plate element. Otherwise, I would get too high soil stresses underneath my plate. So this is how you calculate it. So you say that the weight of the plate is the specific weight of the whatever structure I have minus the specific weight of the soil times the real thickness. So this is typically what you do. What for soil weight do you use? And people can say, but the soil weight can be below the phreatic level or above the phreatic level. So it can be saturated or unsaturated. Usually you pick whatever you reach in the final situation. It's not worth keep changing the weight of the plate every time your plate element gets above or below the phreatic level. It makes very little difference in the result. So you just pick one. And if you say, well, most of the calculation, this plate is below the water level, pick your saturated soil weight, otherwise pick your unsaturated soil weight. Keep changing it is really not worth the effort. Now, if you would excavate one time one side of it, then of course, in the area that your concrete floor takes takes in reality in my model is going to be half soil, half air, if I put my plate element in the middle, and then the compensation weight of the plate becomes a little bit different. I don't use the structure specific weight minus the soil specific weight, but the structure specific weight minus half the soil specific weight times the thickness. Again, you could say, but I start my model with soil on either side and I end it with only soil on one side. Usually you just take the final situation and determine the weight for that. You could decide to, at some point when you start excavating, change the weight of your plate, but it's an extra step and it doesn't contribute much to your results. So usually we don't do that and we say, well, whatever the final situation is, that is what I determine my plate weight on. And not take into account that it may change because of water levels or excavations or things like that. If we have multiple plates, of course, we may want to interconnect them. So how do we do that? Well, in the picture, you see two plates. If a plate reaches the soil surface, it just is a free end. So it has free rotation, free movement, within the soil. If we reach a plate element reaches the left or the right boundary, then we assume that this is the case because it's an axis of symmetry, because normally you don't want your construction to be close to your boundaries, or the other way around. You don't want your boundaries to be close to your project area. You want them to be far away, to have no influence. But if you only model half of your structure, then you do need a boundary on your axis of symmetry, which in this model is then the left boundary, and then a plate element may end up on this axis of symmetry, which is the boundary. So then we say, well, if your plate element ends up on a boundary, it's probably because it's an axis of symmetry. So we don't allow any rotation there. And because if it's the axis of symmetry, this horizontal plate there will remain horizontal. It may move up or down, but it will remain horizontal. So we apply a fixed rotation there by default. You can remove it if you want to, but it's applied by default. Now, where the floor and the wall come together, if you don't define anything, we just assume they're fully fixed. So the default of this connection between two plates is fully fixed. You have development of bending moments and so on. If you say, but this is not correct. You can change it. So you can say, well, either it should be a hinge, or maybe there's an elastoplastic spring, and you have to do that by defining a connection there. And the definition of a connection is that you define how the end of plate A, the first plate, is connected to the second plate. Now, the first plate we call the custom part. The second part we call the reference part. And I try to make four little graphs underneath to show that. So if I make a connection and we have this vertical in the four pictures, we have the vertical wall and we have a horizontal plate connected to it. If I make the horizontal one, the custom one, and the vertical, the reference one, then what I define is how the connection is where that little yellow ball is. If I make it a hinge, then my vertical plate is an ongoing plate, and my horizontal one is hinged to the vertical one. If in the second picture, my custom part is the top part and the rest is reference, either the bottom part or the other one, then I say, well, I actually have like a fixed angle of the lower vertical part and the horizontal part, they are fixed together. And the top vertical part is connected, for instance, through a hinge to the rest. Whether I make the vertical lower part a reference or the horizontal part a reference, in this case, makes no difference. If the upper vertical part is the custom, that will be the same way. If I want to have more complex connections, I have here the fourth picture is a vertical and a horizontal place crossing. And I can actually specify two connections here with reference one and custom one, reference two and custom two. And if I did it that way, I make hinges, then actually reference one and two are fixed, fully fixed together. And custom one and custom two are both hinged to the other two. So my top right part is a fixed 90 degrees connection, and the other two are hinged together to it. So I can create different separate connections in one and the same point to specify different ways how things are being connected there. Now, a plate element is the most complicated one of the elements we have, so that part we did. Anchors are simple line elements. Your model supports anchors, struts. They're just spring elements. They're just supposed to connect either one point to the outside world, which is what we call a fixed end anchor. So one point is connected to something in our geometry, a wall. The other side of the spring is just fixed. It doesn't move. Typically, we use this, for instance, to model a strut if you only have a half symmetric model. The other type is a node-to-node anchor, where both ends of the anchor are fixed to a point in my geometry, but they just connect those two points through a spring, but the spring has no interaction with the soil in between. We assume an anchor is such a small, thin line element that it doesn't even notice there is soil around. So no interaction between the anchor in between the points and the soil, only the points itself are connected to the soil. We can pre-stress those anchors if you want to. We can put them in different orientations. They also, of course, need to get a material set. Well, the material set is very simple. It's a spring element, so we need a stiffness. We need to specify a distance in between the anchors. It's 2D, so in the out-of-plane direction, which is given in the little picture to the bottom right. So the LL sub S, which is the distance between two anchors. It needs a stiffness EA, an actual stiffness, and I can specify whether the behavior should be elastic, elastoplastic, or elastoplastic with residual strength. So if I make it elastoplastic, I just specify a maximum force, and if the maximum force is reached, then okay, it will keep the maximum force. If I use residual strength, I give it a maximum strength, and a residual strength in case the maximum is reached. Now, this is very interesting because if I put the residual strength to zero, that means I can load my anchor until I reach the maximum strength. And then at the moment I reach it, the strength will reduce to zero. That is like if the anchor failed, whether it's broken. So I can model anchor failure like this, either because the anchor rod breaks, then probably the residual strength is zero. Or I can use it as like a pull out, which I probably mean that I have some residual strength, but considerably lower, let's say 10% of the maximum strength. And when I do that, it is like I'm pulling out my grout body, for instance. So this is what we can do with the anchor. So we can model the breaking of an anchor by putting in a residual strength. We can pre-stress it, as already mentioned. So in any calculation phase, you select the anchor, you go to the selection explorer. There you also can see the anchor. In this case, you see it's a fixed end anchor, the material set that is assigned. Then you have to select the option adjust pre-stress. You have to switch that on, and then you can specify a pre-stress value. Now note that this pre-stress value is really the procedure of pre-stressing. So you put the pre-stress machine on, and then you put on the load. Then of course you connect the anchor to the wall and the machine is gone. So that means that in the phase following the pre-stress should not be on anymore, because we don't keep the load in the anchor constant and the pre-stress value for the whole project. We just pre-stress it, we connect it. So we pre-stress it in Plexus in one phase, and then in the next phase the effect is there, but the adjust pre-stress should be switched off. And Plexus does that automatically. Some people then say, ah, this must be wrong, and they switch it on again. No, it is correct. We pre-stress it, the effect is in the anchor, and after that, we can just release the anchor again, but the effect of the pre-stress is in the anchor and will be taken into account in further calculation. Now we have geotextile or geogrid elements. They're, you could say, a little bit the simplified version of a plate element. They are again 3 or 5 noded elements. They don't have a bending stiffness, they only have axial stiffness. They only allow tension, they don't allow compression. So we assume it's a thin sheet. So I can try to tension it, but if I try to compress it, it will just wrinkle up. So no compression is possible. And again, it can be elastic or elastoplastic. The elastic is again elastic, perfectly plastic. So you specify a maximum axial force and that's it. You can have an N epsilon diagram where you specify a relation between axial force and axial strain so that you can get a nonlinear elastic behavior. And then you have an extra option that plates don't have, and that is viscoelastic. So with viscoelastic, you have to specify initial strain and a strain for time is infinite. And then we can actually model that if we don't do anything and we just let time run, that we can either see ongoing strains because of creep in my geotextile, or if I fixate the length of my geotextile, I can see a reduction of my axial force in my my geotextile, because I have a stress relaxation in my my geogrid. That behavior is not included in the plate element, it is included in a geogrid. So that is a viscoelastic behavior that is unique to the geogrid. Then we have the second last element, embedded beam row. Again, 3 or 5 noded elements, just like a plate. The behavior is in between an anchor and a plate. A plate really forms a wall, and soil that is on the left of the plate will always be on the left of the plate, and what is on the right of the plate will always be on the right, because the plate is a wall, it separates the soil. An anchor, on the other hand, has no idea there is soil, so the soil and the anchor can move freely and they don't interact. An embedded beam row is in between. So it's like a row, you could say a row of piles. So the row of piles, if the soil is horizontal movement, the soil can flow in between the piles, but it does interact. It does give a pressure on the pile, it does have friction with the pile, because the piles are not that small. That is basically how an embedded beam row works. You have to specify a lot of parameters for it. We have to specify the maximum skin friction or the skin resistance, both in the axial as in the lateral direction, because it has interaction with the soil. So we have to specify what is then the maximum skin friction here. You can specify through a linear distribution, multilinear, if you want to specify linear distributions per soil layer. There is an option called layer dependent, where we actually on the fly calculate it based on the normal stress acting on your embedded beam row and the friction angle and the cohesion of the soil. The element has end bearing also through a spring connection. And as I said, it allows soil to flow in between your beam row elements, but they do have some interaction here. So the model was originally created for modeling piles, but you can do actually much more than just piles. Now, these are the parameters. So there's a very extensive material set. So you have to specify some material data, specific weight, elasticity modulus. You have to specify what shape has the pile. Is it a solid circular pile, or is it a hollow tube, or is it a square? You can specify Rayleigh damping for dynamics analysis. And then you have to specify the resistance. The actual skin resistance, or let's say we model a vertical pile, I give it a vertical load. Then, of course, what skin resistance I have in that actual direction. If I would horizontally load my pile in this case, what is the lateral skin resistance? I have to specify the base resistance, so what is my bearing capacity at my foot? So basically, by resistances and the base, I specify the total bearing capacity of the pile. You cannot use embedded beam rows to calculate the bearing capacity. The bearing capacity is implicitly entered in Plexus by specifying the skin resistances and the base resistance. And then the final part is that you have interface stiffness factors. And yeah, this is a 2D model of a row of beams. It's not a real 3D model. So those interface stiffness factors may be used to calibrate the behavior to a real pile model. So you may want to model a pile in Plexus 3D or another software. User wouldn't define anything at all. Now, we got some questions on this, so I'm happy I can hopefully answer them. What are interfaces is a question that occurred a couple of times. Now, an interface, I admit the name is very general, but an interface is an element that we use to model soil structure interaction. Why do I need that? Well, I hope I can show you in the two pictures that are below. The left side shows one soil element with one plate element. The plate element is the blue vertical line on the left side and no interface. So here you see that the three nodes of the plates are the same three nodes that are from the soil element. So if the plate moves, the soil has to move as well because they're glued together. Now we know if you do an excavation and the wall starts moving, that the soil behind it, for instance, if the wall moves inwards inside my excavation, my soil will drop a bit. It will not follow the wall perfectly. It will have a different displacement. This we can reach with an interface element. With an interface element, if we apply it next to the wall, we split the nodes. So now you see in the right picture, my soil element has its nodes, my plate has its nodes, they're not the same nodes, and those nodes from the plate and the soil are connected through little springs. And those little springs have the properties of the soil, but I can give them reduced properties of the soil. And by doing this, if the wall moves, the soil doesn't have to follow, but it has an effect because if the wall moves, I either compress or extend the springs, and therefore it will act as a force on the soil. But the soil can still decide to follow partially or go in a different direction. So there is an interaction between the soil and the plate, but there is no necessity that the plate and the soil have exactly the same displacement. This is what an interface element does. And you can see an output. If you check an interface element, you can see, for instance, normal stresses, shear stresses. So if you do an excavation project, you can, for instance, click on the interface next to your wall and you can see your active soil pressures acting against your wall from the interface. You don't check it from the wall. You check it from the interface. Now, what are the properties of the interface? Well, we take the properties from the soil and by default, and then we use a reduction factor that's called R sub inter. And how does that work? Well, if R sub inter is one, then the interface has the same properties as the soil. But if you put an R sub inter that is less than one, then the cohesion used in the interface is the cohesion of the soil times this reduction factor. We also reduce the tangent of the friction angle of the soil with this factor. So we don't reduce the friction angle itself, but the tangent of the friction angle. If the soil has the latency and R sub inter is less than one, then the latency in the interface is just taken as zero. Otherwise, it's the one of the soil. If you specify a maximum tensile strength in the soil, because you have a cemented soil, for instance, also this maximum tensile strength is reduced with this factor R sub inter to get a maximum tensile strength in the interface. And the stiffness of the soil is in the interface not reduced with the factor R sub inter, but R sub inter square. Be aware of this. If you define an R sub inter of 0.1, then your strength parameters in your interface are going to be 10% of the strength of the soil. But the stiffness in your interface is only going to be 1% of the stiffness of the soil, which is very small. So you may see then some strange behavior. If you say, I don't like this because I don't want to have my cohesion reduced with the same factor as my friction angle, no problem. What you can always do is define a completely different material set with exactly those parameters you want and just assign that to the interface. The use of the factor R sub inter is the default, but it's not the only way. I can specify a material set that has the same cohesion as the soil, but a reduced friction angle, assign it to my interface, and then the interface will calculate with that material set rather than using the one of the adjacent soil with a reduction factor. So you can make different combinations. Using R sub inter is just the default value in this case. Now, what are suggested values for R sub inter? It depends on the level of interaction. If the structure element and the soil are very interconnected, let's say you have a sand and you make a cast in place concrete construction and the concrete enters a little bit the pores of the sand, the concrete wall and the sand are very well connected. So you may have an R inter of 0.8 to even 1. If it's on the other hand, it's a sheet pile wall, it's metal, it's not very rusted, it's very smooth, I have a bit moist clay, the interaction is very smooth. Maybe that R sub inter could be like 0.5. It's not hard science here, so you have to make an educated guess. We generally do not recommend using an R sub inter less than 0.5, unless you have some kind of academic case where you really want to calculate that. But less than 0.5 gives you very little strength and stiffness. There are actually countries where the building code says that there is a minimum value. I know there are several European countries where they say less than 0.5 or 0.6 is just not allowed. It's a rather arbitrary factor, so it should not be critical for your project. How do I know it's critical? Well, the best is if you finish your project with the R sub inters that you calculate, is that you say, well, you know what? I have my project. It's fine like this. I will just now, as the final calculation, I'm happy with the results. I'm about to send in my report. I just go to my project. I set all the R sub inters to 0.5 and I recalculate. It shouldn't fail. If it then fails, then you have a tricky case, because if it then fails, that is probably, especially for excavation, you may have a basal heave problem or something like or an excavation bottom stability problem that you just manage to cover by using an R sub inter that is large enough. You don't want that, and then you may want to investigate slightly if geotechnically speaking you should make a bit of a change, because this R sub inter is very arbitrary. It may be wise to do a check. If I do fill in the 0.5, do I get completely different results compared to the 0.7 I used for my design? It shouldn't be the case, and therefore it may be worth having a check. And you can just run it overnight and the next morning see if it's completely different. It's not something that should take you a lot of time, but it could be wise to do so. Yes. Now, final remark on interfaces. If I have a foundation block that is a very solid block and I put my interfaces around it, as you can see on the top left picture, then I may have the problem that underneath the solid block, some soil elements will be underneath the block, some will be next to the block, but some may be half underneath the block and half not. If this block starts moving, then those soil elements that are partially underneath my solid block and partially next to it may get very heavy deformations and therefore very funny stresses. So you see that on the top three pictures, I have a block, I have an interface just around it, and then on the right side you see that in the corners I get peak stresses. That doesn't always happen. Actually, it happens more often not than it does, but it could be the case. The solution here would be, and you see that in the bottom row of the pictures, is to extend the interfaces a little bit. So you see here that they have been extended a little bit beyond the bottom and the sides of the block. How much you should extend it? Not much. One soil element size is more than enough here. But if you extend them, then you separate the elements really between being either underneath the block or being next to the block, also the first level of elements directly underneath. And then by separating those a little bit, I get smoother stress distribution. If you forget to extend them, it doesn't mean that it's wrong and it will go wrong. It sometimes does. But you may want to just avoid getting into that situation of waiting a few hours for your calculation, find out you have those peak stresses, and then have to change your interfaces, regenerate the mesh, and recalculate by immediately using this extension. This is a numerical thing. So there's no geotechnical engineering behind it. This is a numerical thing. It doesn't always go wrong. Actually, I think it's max 10% of the cases. But you may want to consider this if it's a bigger project that you don't have to start, let's say, going back to structures mode, extend the interfaces, regenerate the mesh, and recalculate, but just do it immediately. So this is just a numerical thing that you have to be aware of. Now, this is the result of the poll. And indeed, I mean, by default, two plates are connected fully fixed. If I don't define it, I make two plates, I let them cross each other. Where they cross each other after mesh generation, they're fully fixed unless I say different. So indeed, answer A here was the correct answer. I put in answer 4, of course, to make a little bit of fun here. We have a professor that occurs frequently in Plexus courses, and his universal answer to any question is, it depends. The problem is, in 99% of the cases, he's right, and it does indeed depend. Here it doesn't, sorry. The connection by default is fully fixed, and it doesn't depend on anything, because that's how we coded it in Plexus. This ends also my presentation on structural elements. So I hope I was able to indicate how structural elements work. Now, for all of you that have been following this until the very end, you can per session get a certificate for this. So you can you have to download it yourself. By logging in, you can get the certificate so that you can at least prove that you are a part of this session. So please do not forget to do so. You don't have to do it immediately. It will remain available for a while. But then, let's say you have some proof that you have been going through this presentation. Now, between now and the next session, there will be some homework involved. Now, we have the possibility to give a very limited amount of training licenses. We have a lot of registrants, so we can for sure not give a training license to everybody. But a lot of you probably already have Plexus through the office. If you have a bit older version than the 2020 Connect edition that we'll be discussing here, you can still do the homework, because not that much has changed over the years to Plexus, so it will be fine. But if you do require a training license for the between now and the 1st of June to be able to make the homework, then please leave your name, company name, and email address. As I said, we will not be able to give everybody a license. We will do our very best. Leave us the data, and then after this session, we will send the necessary information around. Now, what is the homework assignment about? Well, if you download the notes, then you will find two exercises. One is called Warehouse Foundation. It's also sometimes referred to as Eindhoven Warehouse. Eindhoven is the fourth city, if I'm correct, from the Netherlands. And a long time ago, they constructed a warehouse. We made a very simplified model just for you to practice how to use structure elements, a plate and an interface. So that is the picture you see on the top. This is the final situation. So we start with soil. We make an inclined excavation. We install the walls. We install the floor. And then we do a backfill. And then we apply the loads. And the second exercise is tight back excavation, in the past also known as the Limburg excavation. Limburg is a province of the Netherlands. Sorry, a lot of the exercises are based on the Netherlands, since we are, as Plexus, are based in the Netherlands. This is a dry excavation, so you have a couple of layers here, and then you install a wall, you install anchors, and then you excavate, and in the process you install anchors as well. These two exercises are given in your handouts. In the next session on Wednesday, We will discuss a little bit the results of those exercises in like the first half an hour. So I hope you will find the time and have a license to make them. And that also ends this first session. I can check if there are still some questions that are very urgent to answer. I don't know if there is anything here. Well, some people are asking to get a copy of the slides. You should have in your screen an option to see the resources. And in the resources, it contains a PDF that is the handout of this whole presentation, both the exercises as well as the slides. Some questions on pore pressures. We will talk about pore pressures on Wednesday. So those questions I would have to move a little bit. The same on people saying, yeah, what should I use, K-naught or gravity loading? Again, then we will discuss this on Wednesday. So those things are also going to be later. Another interesting question somebody said, yeah, I have a pile and I want to apply a lateral load. Can I do this in an axisymmetric model? No, you cannot. Because an axisymmetric model really means that from all directions, on all radial directions, the model has to be the same. If you apply a lateral load in an axisymmetric model, you actually apply this lateral load from all possible directions on the head of your pile, which means your pile head is not going to move because you're going to apply a load from all possible directions. A single lateral load on a pile is actually a 3D problem. It sounds a bit silly for such a small thing to have to use a 3D model, but it actually is, because it's not plane strain, because that is a lateral load on a wall. And it's not axisymmetric because the load is not axisymmetric. So this actually would be a 3D case. What happens if multiple boreholes have different water levels? We actually do an interpolation in between the water levels. So you will actually end up with a water level that just is based on linear interpolation between the water levels as specified in the boreholes. So that is pretty straightforward to model. And some people have been asking already in the past, what does check geometry does? Well, if you're making a very complex geometry, you may, by mistake, or create a very small area, a very thin area in your model that visually you cannot see unless you zoom in a lot. You're not going to zoom in and then with a looking glass go over your whole model. If you do check geometry, it will, for instance, tell you that indeed you created two lines very close together, or you thought that two lines were intersecting, but they are not. This is the kind of stuff that check geometry will tell you. So it will tell you, say, well, these two lines are very close, but they don't intersect. And maybe you did want them to intersect. Or maybe you were not even aware of the fact that there were two lines there. You thought it was only one. And then, of course, you can remove one of the two. So this is what check geometry can do for you. I'm also looking a little bit to my colleagues if they have any further remarks to be made. If that is not the case, then I would like to thank everybody for their attention. And I hope you can do the homework. On Wednesday, we will discuss that a little bit. And then on Wednesday, we will continue with some more details about meshing, about initial stresses, and also about modeling groundwater. So then, from my part, I would like to thank you all for joining, and we will hear and see each other again on the Wednesday. So, and yeah, enjoy your day. Or for those of you who are in Asia, I hope you can get some sleep and not have got too much information and stay awake over it. Thank you.